Penguin Random House Audio presents Shielded, How the Police Became Untouchable. This is the author, Joanna Schwartz. Ignorance, allied with power, is the most ferocious enemy justice can have. James Baldwin. Introduction. On the afternoon of February 8th, 2018, more than two dozen law enforcement officers crowded into a conference room in the Henry County Sheriff's Office on the outskirts of Atlanta. They were preparing to execute a no-knock warrant at 305 English Road, the home of a drug dealer who'd been under investigation for almost 2 years and had gathered for a briefing about the operation. The special agent leading the briefing told the team that 305 English Road was a small house with off-white siding and several broken-down cars out front, showed them an aerial photograph of the house, and gave them turn-by-turn directions to get there. All of the members of the task force had the opportunity to review a copy of the warrant, which described the target house and its surroundings. But only one, Captain David Cody, who was leading the operation, took the time to read it. And even Captain Cody didn't read it all the way through. The officers piled into their SUVs to head to 305 English Road, but ignored the directions they received during the briefing. Instead, an officer plugged the address into the GPS on his cell phone, and the convoy got lost. When the officers finally arrived at their destination, the house described in the warrant was right in front of them. Run down, off-white, with cars strewn across the yard. But the entry team walked swiftly past 305 English Road and toward 303 English Road, 40 yards away. The house at 303 English Road looked nothing like the house described in the briefing and in the warrant. It was tidy and yellow, with a carefully maintained grass yard. The mailbox at the end of the driveway made abundantly clear that it was not the house the task force was looking for. Yet less than a minute after getting out of their cars, officers deployed flash grenades outside 303 English Road and used battering rams to smash open all three doors of the home. Inside, they found Henri Norris, a 78-year-old black man wearing a baseball cap, jeans, and a windbreaker. For more than 50 years, until February 8, 2018, Norris had lived peacefully at 303 English Road. He and his wife had raised their three children there. He had spent decades traveling back and forth from that home to his job at a nearby rock quarry. Now Norris was retired and lived alone. Although he was still married to his wife, they got along better living separately and saw each other on Sundays at church. His children had grown up, moved away, and had children of their own. Norris was no drug dealer. He had never been in any trouble with the law. He'd never even received a traffic ticket. Henri Norris was watching the evening news in an armchair in his bedroom when he heard a thunderous sound, as if a bomb had gone off in his house. He got up to see what the commotion was and found a crowd of men in military gear in his hallway. Norris was more than twice as old as the target of the search warrant. But the officers pointed assault rifles at him anyway and yelled at him to raise his hands and get on the ground. When Norris told the officers that his knees were in bad shape, an officer grabbed Norris, pushed him down, and twisted his arm behind his back. Norris's chest began to hurt, and he had trouble breathing. He told the officers that he had heart trouble. He'd had bypass surgery and used a pacemaker. But they kept him on the ground for several minutes and never sought medical care. Norris was eventually picked up and led outside in handcuffs. When the officers realized that they had blasted their way into the wrong house, they turned their cameras off one by one. Whatever one believes about the job of policing, whether it's that well-intentioned officers often must make split-second decisions that are easy to criticize in hindsight, or that the profession is corrupt by its very nature, videos that have filled our screens in recent years offer concrete evidence that the police sometimes egregiously abuse their authority. And these videos only scratch the surface of injustices that occur. Before Minneapolis police officer Derek Chauvin knelt on George Floyd's neck on May 25th, 2020, many others died beneath the knees of police officers. Before Louisville police officer Miles Cosgrove fired 16 times into Breonna Taylor's apartment on March 13th, 2020, many others were shot during no-knock police raids. Countless people, disproportionately Black and Brown, whose names you've never heard, have been unjustifiably killed, assaulted, arrested, searched and surveilled by police. Of course, many people have been saved and protected and comforted by police as well. While there may be disagreement about how often police officers abuse their power, hopefully we can agree that police sometimes do abuse their power in ways that leave people dead, hurt, or humiliated, and that when they do, there should be meaningful accountability for law enforcement officers and officials and justice for their victims. People who've lost loved ones or have themselves been harmed by the police often say they want the officers involved to be punished and assurance that something similar won't happen in the future. That's what Henri Norris and his children and grandchildren wanted as well. In our current system, there are really only three paths toward this type of justice, and none is easy to travel. One option is criminal prosecution. Police officers can be arrested, charged with crimes, and sent to prison. If you believe that our prisons are already too full, you may not have much appetite for a solution that puts more people behind bars. But even if some manner of justice could come from the criminal prosecution of a police officer, it rarely does. Prosecutors have historically been disinclined to bring charges against the officers they rely on to get convictions in other cases. And juries have proven reluctant to indict officers or find them guilty of crimes that will send them to prison. As a result, police officers are criminally charged in less than 2% of fatal shootings and convicted in less than 1/3 of those cases. Officers are even less likely to be prosecuted for using force that does not kill or for violating people's rights in other ways. Police officers also can be investigated, disciplined, and fired by their departments. But police departments' internal affairs divisions rarely sustain allegations of misconduct. Internal affairs divisions in departments across the country have been criticized for conducting shoddy investigations, failing to interview witnesses, collect and preserve evidence, reconcile inconsistent statements, or question when officers submit essentially verbatim statements that suggest collusion. In the rare event that charges are sustained, officers often have elaborate processes they can use to challenge departments' decisions to discipline or fire them, and those challenges are often successful. As a result, local police departments can't be relied upon to render justice to their own. Deputies from the sheriff's office repaired Henri Norris's doors a few days after they broke them down, but nothing ever came of the civilian complaint Norris filed against Captain Cody and members of the task force. And no criminal charges were ever brought against the officers who blasted through the doors of Norris's home, pushed him to the floor, handcuffed him, and scared him to death. For Henri Norris, the only path towards some manner of justice was to sue Captain Cody and the officers who busted into his home. In many ways, a lawsuit was more likely to achieve Norris's goals than a criminal prosecution or internal investigation ever could. Norris could file a lawsuit himself. He didn't have to wait for a prosecutor or a local department's internal affairs division to act. During litigation, Norris could demand documents from the law enforcement agencies that participated in the task force and could question officers and supervisors under oath about what happened. Information that a prosecutor or internal affairs investigator would be under no obligation to unearth or make public. If Norris could prove that the officers violated his constitutional rights, he could be awarded money to compensate him for the pain, fear, and humiliation he felt, a remedy not available from criminal prosecutions or internal affairs investigations. And that money might not only compensate Norris, but also encourage Captain Cody and the rest of the task force to be more careful in the future. As the U.S. Supreme Court has explained, the threat of being sued should cause government officers who may harbor doubts about the unlawfulness of their intended actions to err on the side of protecting citizens' constitutional rights. And judgments against cities should lead them to discharge offending officials and institute internal rules and programs designed to minimize the likelihood of unintentional infringements on constitutional rights. For Henri Norris, and for many people, filing a lawsuit is the best available way to punish police when they violate the law and give police reason not to violate the law again. But Norris soon discovered, as have so many others, that justice through a civil rights lawsuit is profoundly elusive. Courts, legislatures, and officials at every level of government have created so many protections for police officers and other government officials at every stage of litigation that a person who has had their life shaken to the very core by government misconduct can have the courthouse doors shut in their face. The best known of these protections is qualified immunity. Qualified immunity is a defense created by the Supreme Court that protects officers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.